Shalom, Rabbi.
Shabbat shalom. All right. Well, this psalm, if I had to name it, I don't know. Maybe so great, yet so gracious. That would be a good title for the song. Infinitely high, yet intimately nigh. I don't know. But it's the first of the Hallel psalms that is said usually during Sukkot. And it starts out with a nice Hebrew word with an exclamation point, and it goes like this. Hallelujah! Yeah, don't worry about it. This is, you can interact. It's not weird. Like, if you want to know, I forget to say something, or I go off on a bunny trail or something, you could say, hey, Rabbi, what's going on? It's all right. Just don't be obnoxious. Now, I think it just answers some questions. Like, the first question would be, who? Because hallelujah is praise the Lord. That's what it means. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. So who? It says, servants of Adonai give praise. That's you guys. Because the world is just, you know, not going to praise the Lord. They're not. Unless somebody sneezes, then you're going to hear them go, God bless you. But they're not going to praise the Lord. Like, that's up to you. Like, you're his children. Everybody's made in God's image, but everybody cannot call God Abba Father. There's some ministers out there go, oh, we're all sons and daughters of God. No, we're not. We're all made in God's image. That's what Genesis says. You know what I'm saying? Not everybody could just call me dad. My kids can. You know? Biologically, they can call me dad. Spiritually, we can call the Lord dad if we connect through Yeshua. That's what this says. And unless you have another commentary or another religious book that tells me differently, I'm going with this one. This one is time-tested and proven. Servants of Adonai give praise. And then it says, just in case you're not sure, I guess it says, you know, give praise to the name. Now, I've told you this a million times. Name is Shem in Hebrew. That's why religious Jews call God Hashem, the name. They don't want to put a name on him. Because the minute you name something, you limit it. And because God is limitless, we can't name him. But the best I could tell you is Shem means his reputation. So, you know, you give people praise for their reputation, right? If somebody's integrous, if they're doing it, they have expertise, you praise them. And there's no problem with praising people. You can give your kid some praise. You can give a coworker some praise. But when it comes to worship, that is only for one entity and one only. You can praise many things, but you can only or should only worship God. So at least it says, give praise to the name, the reputation, the renown of Adonai. And then blessed be the name. Bless him. That means get on your knees and salute him, man. You know, he's not your buddy. This new wave aftershave crap that's going around churches today where, you know, what's our motto? Love God, love others, have fun. You sound like you're at a sweet 16. You sound like a little girl. That's how you subject yourself to God? Sound like a little high schooler? Man, it's so sad what I see going on. It's not just watered down. There's not enough liquid to make soup for a dying grasshopper. It's not a little watered. It's ridiculous. Ridiculous. So it says, now when should we bless the name of the Lord? From this moment, that's right now. Not later. Not when you get home, not tomorrow, from this moment and forever. From sunrise, that means the moment you get up. From sunset till you go to bed. In your waking consciousness all throughout the day. Adonai's name is to be praised, it says. Adonai is high above the nations, his glory above the heavens. Did you read that or hear that? Rather hear that. Some of you are reading it. Let me read it again. Adonai is high above all nations, his glory above the heavens. He doesn't live in heaven. He's above the heavens. Genesis 1:1 says in the beginning, that's when time started. Where was God? There was no time. Even if you don't believe in a young earth, even if you think the earth is a trillion years old, but there's an infinity amount of time prior to that. Because there was no time. There was no space. There was no matter. There was God. He made the heavens. When it says in Genesis 1:1, he made the heavens, he made all three. He made the atmosphere where the birds fly. Read Genesis. He made the stellar heavens where the stars of the universe is. And then he made a heaven for his abode. But prior to that, he was. And you can't wrap your mind around it, no matter how intellectual you are. And guess what? That makes you, you, me, me, and God, God. Deal with it. God forbid you're able to figure God out. How can you worship something you're able to figure out? I think we're gonna have some fun today. Not the kind of fun that you're thinking of. Listen to this now. This is crazy talk. Who is like Adonai our God, seated in the heights, humbling himself to look on heaven? I told you he was higher than heaven. He has to stoop down to look at heaven. What God humbles himself? Are you crazy? I've been all over the world. I've met people that believe in all kinds of gods. Their gods are not humble. This is fancy talk. I'll get into it. That's why I'm reading the psalm. It's fancy talk. In theological circles, we call God transcendent. Now, what five-year-old knows what transcendent is? Most of you don't know what transcendent is. Or we say he's sovereign. We have to say it like that. You have to say, when you say sovereign, you have to sound like Shakespeare. Old Bill Shakespeare. He's sovereign. God. But the truth is, he is transcendent. He is so sovereign. I'll break it down for you later. Promise. He raises the poor from the dust, lifts the needy from the rubbish heap. Now, are there anybody here who's born again? Then that's you. You weren't rubbish, but trust me, you were found on the rubbish heap. He didn't call you rubbish, but trust me, your lifestyle and what you were doing and what you were thinking was rubbish. Some call this going from the outhouse to the penthouse. Not me. What do I call it? Going from the projects to the palace. That's where I got it from. Psalm 113, that's the verse. So not only does he take you off the rubbish heap, he doesn't just neutralize you. It says, in order to give him, that's you and me, a place among princes. You follow? You see, every king has to have a king, kingdom. Every kingdom has to have a king, right? Every kingdom has to have a king, and every king has to have subjects. Well, if you're subjects in this kingdom, right, and the king of kings happens to be your father, that makes you a prince and a princess. You might not feel like it, and the reason why you don't feel like it is because you're stuck in earth. You're stuck in the gears of earth. You're stuck in the temporal. You're stuck in the finite. You just keep thinking, well, I drive this and I live here and I don't have this and all that. You'll never feel like a prince or a princess in the kingdom. Never. You can't have both. It says he causes the childless woman. Do you know what the childless woman, the barren woman? In Judaism, that's the worst. It's scornful. It's a reproach. It's shame. It's utter disgrace. When a woman, we didn't have what we have today, you know, mad scientists shooting people up with stuff. Back then, either you got pregnant or you didn't. When you didn't get pregnant, it was like they just thought of it, you must have sin or you're suffering from your parents' sin. It was shameful. They looked down upon you. Oh, you can't get pregnant? What's wrong with you? What did you do? It was shameful. So God's using this metaphorically. He's saying he causes the childless woman to live at home happily as a mother of children. There was no greater occasion. There's no greater extravagant joy than for a woman to give birth. So he's showing this crazy contrast. He's saying, you were reproach on that rubbish heap. You felt it. You know, before you were born again, you felt terrible about yourself. Still, you still struggle, right? I'm just a bum. I'm no good. I know I say it all the time, but that's not what God says about us. We were like the childless woman, scorned, reproached. And now we're experiencing the most extravagant joy. So how does this psalm end? Tell me. You nailed it. Good. Father, thank you so much for this blessed day. Thank you so much that in your infinite wisdom, you set aside one day in the week. One day you set aside. You knew what we needed. You're the manufacturer. You knew what we needed. We needed one day of rest. And sadly enough, Father, so many of these people are not going to take it. They're already sitting here thinking, well, I hope this ends here because then I got to go here and then I got to do this. I got to stop at Walmart. I got to pick up this. Then I got to go home and fix that and do this. They're not going to take Shabbat. They're not going to listen to you. They think they know better. Take the day. The little broken cabinet will wait for you tomorrow. Take the day. Stop running and gunning your life away. Listen to God. Try it. Test Him of this, if you will. So, Father, we bless you because you know better. Father knows best. That's for sure. And I pray that you are blessed today. I pray that somehow, some way, by our feeble, finite attempt to bring you glory, you're going to kick back and say, I like them. They make me happy. We love you. You're the best. Be blessed. In Yeshua's name we pray. Amen. Shabbat shalom, guys.